someone else doesn't have one, mine doesn't have yours open, so.
There are 5 copies here, so.
Plus the one for the office?
I have 5 for here, and then I have 1 for the office.
Okay, sorry, I already have one.
So.
Are you Ralph?
I'm Sarah.
Oh, let's put a face to the name.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Do you have extra copies of your plans?
Yes.
Okay, so. I have a couple here.
You were replying, and then he kept asking.
I know.
Okay, so I thought you replied.
I did, and he apparently missed that, and I followed up again, and he said.
Is somebody else missing?
We're missing John Hensman, our chair.
Oh, yeah.
Glenn Chase, if he comes, who's an alternate. John Krebs, who's our planning consultant.
And Miles.
And Miles is gone, because I am now the ex officio. So I'm replacing Miles, so.
Is that accepted?
Yes, it is. So Richard is here taking either the vacancy or Miles' spot, and then we've got Sue Nastasi, who is appointed to the other vacancy. So we now have a full board.
That's nice. And you can qualify as ex officio? Are you on the board now?
No.
I don't get town administrator.
But I can stand in for them for certain things, yes.
Hi.
Hi, so this is Sue Nastasi.
Hi, how are you?
And this is Kevin Haynes.
I'm Kevin, good to meet you.
Hi, Kevin.
And this is Richard Fogarty.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Hi, Richard.
And this is Sarah, she's our secretary.
And your librarian.
And she's also the library director.
That's right.
It's a small town.
It's a very small town.
Many hats.
And. What are these?
Have one.
There'll be a quiz next month.
Those are state planning regs. It's a manual, reference manual, if there's a specific thing you're not sure of. There's an index, and you can try to figure out what the state law says about it.
Oh, maybe I shouldn't have downloaded. All that. Hang on. Okay.
This one comes with an index. Well, yeah, so. End of this.
Is the entire report covered?
Yeah.
Wow. That's nice.
Oh, I thought I was doing the right thing.
Certainly good if they want to, like, circulate the responses.
Quickly, yeah.
John Hensman, our chair, who's not here yet.
Oh, okay.
And then we have John Krebs, who is our planning consultant, who's not here yet.
Oh, okay. And maybe Glenn Chase?
He's an alternate who is not here.
Okay. Is he, do you expect him, just wondering?
He typically comes.
Oh, good. I know.
He hasn't been here the last couple of
Wendy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I could tell by the walk.
I think you need to pull up a chair. And thank you for coming, and I'm sorry about all that confusion.
No worries.
No, it's me, John, that can tell by walks.
We'll steal this chair, then.
So, John, you're sitting next to Sue Nastasi, who's one of our new members.
John Krebs, how are you?
And across from you is Richard Fogarty, he's our other new member.
Hello, Richard.
Nice to meet you, John.
Good to meet you.
Hi.
Hi, Sarah, how are you?
There's some plants for you. Finally.
Oh. Yes.
Sure. So just to start, this is the Rollinsford Planning Board, April 2nd, 2019. And so we have a couple new members, Rich and Sue, correct?
Yep.
So I'm John Hinsman, I'm the chairman. Kevin, who is the vice chair. Caroline, who's our town administrator. And Sarah, who is our note taker. And John Krebs was a very able technical advisor. So, welcome. We appreciate your volunteering very, very much. So, I see we have nice good books. So, all right.
So, can you spell your last name?
Sure. N-A-S-T-A-S-I.
N-A-S-T-I.
No. N-A-S-T-A-S-I.
So I think that the first order of business tonight is going to be the site plan review, correct?
I was thinking you might reappoint in your position as it's a new year.
Yeah?
Don't mind.
I'll second
you
that.
Sure, right. You sure you don't want to become chairman? Okay, all right. So all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, all right. So that sounds like we need to make a motion to then reappoint Kevin as vice chair. So I'll make that motion.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right.
Thank you.
That was okay. All right. And by the way, Sue and Richard, is should you really enjoy this, I would invite you to put your names in for chairman next year. I've got no firm hold on this. It's Oh, thank you very much. Thank you very much. All right. So you, now I think we'll talk about the site plan review. John, I'm going to defer to you first and ask if you have any comments or so you think you should know before we begin.
Well, I know you, I think you've been away from your email, but just to explain to everybody, this is I've seen this tonight for the very, very first time. I have no idea what's going on. I never saw these plans, so
would you like me to give a little background?
Sure.
Okay. So Mr. Phipps submitted a building permit. Ralph, why don't you come sit at the table with us?
Sure.
So he submitted a building permit for a located on Turgeon Way, where he has a business already, a landscaping business. The home will have most of its space dedicated to the business, but have living quarters. So it's an expansion of the business use, but it's also an added use. I would suggest that the home is an accessory use to the business, which I believe is a non-conforming use in that district.
Well, the business is, so the business is non-conforming. It's zoned, that's zoned
it's,
country residential, isn't it?
Suburban. It's
suburban
one or suburban two, yeah.
Can I ask a question? Was that agricultural bought land, I think?
So agricultural uses are allowed, but it is not an agricultural zone. It's a suburban zone where agricultural uses are allowed. But I'm going to go grab the zoning ordinance because it didn't seem to me that it fit necessarily.
It doesn't matter. I mean, if you look at the table of uses, it's a residential zone. Whether it's country residential or
so that part is allowed. I don't know if it'll come into play with regard to an expansion of a non, you know, the evolution of a non-conforming.
Yeah, I think this is a trickier one than, it sounds like a very easy thing, but it's not as easy as, I was of the understanding this was going to be a home occupation. But you're not living in this house, are you?
There's no house.
So it's an apartment with a shop.
Yeah, there's nothing there right now.
No, I understand that, but you have a plan here showing
the house. Yes, that's going to be a house.
But you're not living in it. It's going to be a rental.
No, I'm going to live there.
So this is. Are you abandoning your other business? So what's the big?
There's a business there. I'm building a house with a shop.
For the business.
So he can live at the business.
The business has been there for like 10 years.
You don't live on site?
No, I don't.
I mean, I don't know what, I don't think this is the right port for Ralph to be at. I mean, it's clearly an expansion of a non-conforming use that I don't think you have the right to approve.
Maybe, maybe not. And the reason that Tom Clark thought that this would be the appropriate first step, although he was questioning that, but we came to this determination and questioned it after this meeting was all duly noticed and so forth. So he believes that it is with, so to be clear.
Who's here? Tom?
Tom Clark.
Yep.
So we were talking about this in light of a recent ZBA case where it was discussed exhaustively the idea of a non-conforming use evolving. And while our zoning ordinance does not allow non-conforming uses to expand, court, you know, there is court law.
Case law,
thank you.
Yeah.
That has proven that businesses that are even non-conforming are allowed to evolve.
Sure.
Which
absolutely
suggests that we have to revise the language in our zoning ordinance. So that being said, under that idea, having had that case recently, he is believing that this is a natural evolution of a business that is non-conforming and that the proposed home would be an accessory use.
It's not really evolving the business. The business is going to continue through this process, and what we're adding to that is a permitted use in that zone.
Right, but what is evolving is the fact that you're adding
the
to
the use
not,
is evolving.
Well, that it is not staying. So the existing business use is non-conforming, but that it is evolving in the sense that you are adding a structure to it. So it is expanding, but it is expanding not necessarily in a non-allowed manner, but in an evolution.
But not in the business sense, but more towards the residential sense. If that's a permitted use in that zone, and the business is not evolving or being abandoned or being altered. The business
but it's expanding because the home, it seems, and Ralph, correct me if I'm wrong, is 2,400 square feet, 1,600 to be for the business and 800 square feet to be living quarters.
Okay. So part of the construction is for business purposes.
Well, it's really mostly by square footage for the business.
Then I can see the word evolving.
I'm sorry that you guys had to come to this meeting. Probably not the best first meeting to come to. I'm really concerned. We have another problem, and that is the chairman of our board happens to sit on the zoning board. And I'm concerned about John. I don't know if you want to weigh in or you want to stay the heck out of this thing. I'm not your zoning officer. I think the selectmen technically are the zoning officers. I don't think Tom is. Tom is a code officer.
He helps to interpret such matters on behalf of the select board. But you're right, he's not the deciding authority necessarily. But I would say that the ZBA probably is if this board decides that.
Absolutely. You know, the zoning board is clearly the board. My opinion is that I just don't think that adding a, I'm not saying this is a bad idea. I don't want to say anything, but I don't think this board has the authority to grant the approval to expand a non-conforming business without the approval of the zoning board. And that doesn't, you know, that doesn't, and I don't really agree with Tom's position that, you know, yes, non-conforming uses can expand. That doesn't mean that a home occupation or a home business with four employees can turn into a Liberty Mutual. That's not, you know, but can they add an employee maybe? Yeah, perhaps. Could they expand the footprint of their non-of their office building that might be in a residential zone in a very minor way? Sure. That those are the expansions that case law has supported. But I just don't think the planning board should be the board to make this determination. I mean, this is a pretty complicated zoning issue that really ought to be, I think
it's going to ZBA. I think at some point, but it's the starting point.
I mean, the site plan review is going to take 2 seconds by the planning board if the zoning board says it's an allowed expansion of a non-conforming use, it's a pretty, it's obviously, that's a big lot, it's a no-brainer. But I don't think I don't think you have the right to approve the use. But I'm looking at this tonight for the first time, I've never talked to Tom. I know where Trojan Way is, I drive by it every day. I'm certainly not trying to complicate matters, but I don't think you have the authority to approve it.
Would it matter to you the use of the business portion of the proposed structure relative to the existing use and how, like the square footage impact and the square footage change?
I can tell you when mixed building was permitted to expand with a building permit, the planning board went ballistic. And that was a bad mistake that the selectmen learned. The selectmen learned their mistake, that they should never allow mixed construction to build that building without zoning board approval. It was a horrible mistake. The board of selectmen acknowledged it, they said it would never happen again. I don't think this is a whole lot different. This is a new building on a lot, a new building with a residence and a shop in a non-conforming use. So I don't know under what authority Tom thought the planning board could approve it.
I don't think that he was necessarily sure that they could, but it was about the complexity of the issue and some further thought, while at the same time he's noticed for this meeting. So rather than cancel this duly posted meeting and defer him, he might as well go through this board and hear its thoughts. So I think it is likewise not completely clear to Tom, and I think he would be open to an argument such as you're suggesting.
I think I personally think I'm inclined to agree with John on this, that I don't think we do have the authority to do what's being contemplated here.
But was this noticed as a preliminary consultation?
No, it's like fully noticed.
Fully, but as a site view, not a site view, but.
Yeah,
site review.
The application
was first.
Okay.
Yeah, Ruff was told to submit a site plan application.
Can I look at this, John, right here?
Sure,
yeah. Those are house plans. Ruff, this is septic design. Which lot are you? This one here.
Two.
Okay. And your business is on that lot? You already own that lot?
Yes.
Okay.
The business has been there for 10 years.
Yeah. And what's on three?
It's nothing.
Oh.
There's nothing on it.
Just raw land.
Just raw land.
Yeah.
And that, what's on here? It's
Kim
Sable there.
Right. Yep.
This shed is existing currently.
Yes. There's another shed up through.
I see this is a different lot though, but I was looking at this shed here. You're talking parcel two, lot two.
Yes. That's an existing, there was the butcher shop.
I think I remember when this subdivision was approved. It wasn't that many years ago.
12 years ago. You've been there 10 years. So did you, the planning board never, you never got, you just bought the lot and moved down to it.
I was under the understanding that it was agricultural when I bought it.
Well, I guess what I'm trying to say is I don't even know if it's, I don't know if it's legally non-conforming. I don't know if, I mean, if that was 10 years ago, the zoning hasn't changed in 20 years.
No, I don't think
so. I don't, unless there was something, this subdivision was created in 2007. So I would assume Ralph bought the lot shortly after the subdivision.
Well, I was involved kind of day one was done, yeah.
So apparently you see Mike, I mean, now you see Mike on that. I don't, I mean, to be a non-conforming business, you had to predate zoning. This, there's no approval for this business at all. I mean, it was only 10 years ago that it started there, or that it was moved there.
Just as an aside, I had a letter from the select board last year, or the year before, I'm not exactly sure, saying that the town was fine with what I was doing on the land, when they took it out of current use. So, the board is on record.
No, I hope you understand, I'm not trying to find a way to submarine this thing, I'm trying to find a... a way to fix it, but it's not the way it's gone, hasn't.
And Mr. Phipps, what had been the context of the select board sending you that letter? Why did they?
They took the land out of current use.
Oh, okay.
They found that the use of the land did not qualify for current use and required that part of it be removed.
I see.
All of those, right?
Oh, okay. Sorry.
But at the time, you didn't say anything about that the use was permitted. It was just that it didn't qualify for current use. That's probably what the letter said.
The letter was really pertaining to the current use as to whether or not it was allowed as, you know, under current use regulations.
Right.
It was not about the use itself.
So. If you were involved in the subdivision from the beginning, I'm assuming you know the first thing about the lot from the beginning.
Yeah.
I mean, I almost just wonder if a variance is the way to go and clean it right up to allow the use. But, I can't.
I mean, it sounds like that's the way it should go to me, but what do you think, Kevin?
I mean, what did the variance?
What's that?
I mean, what you said about variance.
Well, I don't think you can expand a non-conforming use that wasn't, it's not, I don't think it's a non-conforming use. It was not permitted, so it's. I think a variance is the way to go, and you know, you've been there forever. Obviously, the neighbors don't care. So I wouldn't think. Although
I'm quite a ways.
I better be careful.
I'm quite a ways from anything.
I didn't say that.
You know, original owner and Gary.
A gentleman in the back wants to be recognized. Anyone have an objection to recognize a gentleman in the back? You could state your name, sir, and
my name's Robert
your address.
Robert Meegan. I'm his next door neighbor over there. I own the other half of that.
Okay.
And I'm real familiar with this because I own the other side.
Can you show us where you are?
Yep.
About three.
I own this one.
Okay. And you, okay. There's nothing there?
No, there's nothing.
Okay.
What is your address?
My street address is 457 Lucas Street. Ralph's been a great neighbor, and everybody knew what he wanted to do from the time he bought it. Kim, Amon, me, and you know what? Whatever it takes to get him this thing, we highly support. And I know the other neighbors around the same way. Nobody's opposed to this. I have to see this, and I want to come and speak up for him.
All right, well, thank you. And I think that, just to be clear, we're not trying to prevent, we're just trying to find the appropriate legal mechanism under which this can be considered.
So just to explain to the board, Richard,
yeah.
Richard and
yeah.
Sue, how this normally works. Normally when a project comes in, they would send the engineer, the surveyor would send me the plans a couple weeks in advance. I would review them, I'd give you a written review of what I think should happen. You don't need to listen to me, but I'll go through the whole thing and make recommendations. this is a case where I didn't know what was going on until I saw it tonight. Generally, they're not this complicated. Usually, it's a subdivision in a residential zone that's pretty easy, or a commercial a site plan in a commercial zone. So this is a little bit. I know it's a small project, but the legal issues are a little bit more complicated. So they normally don't go like this. So don't run. But as John said, I think that, I want you to know, Ralph. I hate when this happens. But I don't want you to think that I'm trying to just look through the book to try to find reasons to say no to this thing. But I also don't think this board can approve something or act on it unless you have the legal authority, and I don't think you do. And I'm surprised Tom didn't catch the fact that this is really not a non-conforming use. It's not. It doesn't. It was never permitted there, and I'm not saying I'm not saying it couldn't be. And clearly, a landscaping business is the worst. You're not going to buy commercially zoned property in downtown Rollins for to run a landscaping business. It's sort of an odd business in the sense that you take up a lot of room, and it's not a brick and mortar business, but.
I had the business in the residential area 40 years in Rollinson. And I was a member of this board back in the 70s, so I'm familiar with what you're doing.
Yeah.
My big question is my time frame. You want to go to a zoning board, and then after the zoning board, you have to come back here?
Well, I think, first of all, in terms of the zoning board, you could probably get the zoning board in relatively. What's his time frame, Sarah, for? We don't meet regularly. The zoning board doesn't meet regularly, but I just met last week or the week before.
Yeah. I mean, usually within 2 to 3 weeks, we can schedule something.
And then, so that's a month, and I have to come back here in another month?
Well, but I can see happening. This board could continue this application, so you don't have to renotice it until the regular meeting in May. So approximately a month from today, which would allow you to go to the zoning board and get whatever relief you need from them and come back to us. So conceivably, in a month, a month and a few days, you could walk out of here with the approval. That's predicated on the zoning board.
Yeah. So we have. I can't make any promises. We have a meeting scheduled for another hearing.
April 16th, right?
Yeah, so potentially if you got an application in right away, it would give me time to notice it so that you could do it on the same day, which would get you a decision to get back here for the main meeting.
And the other matter on for the 16th is a relatively straightforward matter. I don't think this
is not complicated.
Problems with that one at all.
So, Sarah, if Ralph came and saw you, or Kara, who I don't know how he does it, but tomorrow, and file an application.
Yeah. I have all those labels. It'd be easy to do.
Would that?
That'd be fine. I'm just time frames.
So I think.
So
it's
something
seems
like
a.
What's that?
Well, do you have to open the hearing?
I think John did, but he probably should formally open it, yeah.
So are any members of the public here who would like to comment on this time? All right, so I think I would entertain a motion to continue the hearing until our next meeting in May.
So moved.
Second.
All right, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
So, Ralph, the only thing I would tell you is that if for some reason the zoning board can't hear you between now and whenever the meeting is in May, the first week of May, you need to let someone know, probably John or Caroline know, that you want to continue the meeting until June. Otherwise, we'll just deny it, and if we don't know what's going on, we'll just let it go. So let someone know if you can't be ready. I'm sure you will. It sounds like you know what's going on, but I just don't want you to be disappointed that,
So, just to clarify, I have to come and fill out a different application.
Yes, I actually am going to email you the application for the variance and then fill it out, bring it into Caroline, and then I'll get the...
And then she can notice it or determine whether or not there's enough time to notice it for that meeting or whether or not a different meeting will need to be set.
Okay.
I mean, I haven't... I'm just about to notice the other meeting I'm hearing the 16th, so it's plenty of time.
Does this all have to be posted like this meeting was?
Mm-hmm. But Sarah's ready to do that.
Yeah, so ready. So okay. I just didn't know if all the mail is having well.
Yeah, yeah, you can piggyback your application. So.
Yeah.
But then you know, the final thing is, Ralph, and I don't know who I know that you have something from Atlantic Survey and something from Civil Consultants, but what we really want is... if you look at the site plan review, what the planning board is going to want to look at is just, you know, where the house is going on the lot. And then, you know, an idea of like where vehicles are parked. We sort of need to know what's going on the lot. So I don't think you need to hire a surveyor to do it. You could probably just draw it on the plan saying this is where the vehicles are parked. I don't know what you have up there. I don't know if you have mulch piles or you know, whatever, but you at least ought to show that on the plan so the board can say, yeah, we know what's going on. The zoning board may even want that. Or maybe photographs, if you have them, that might be helpful, or, you know, but the more information.
And the maps of it right now, so you can kind of get a purview of sort of how it lays on the land.
The piles and field with compost. Compost everything,
it's not even visible from Rollins Road. It's really, we would want to have that type of business, and to have already heard from abutters that it's been a positive 10 years. That certainly carries some.
Yeah, that's very. Now what's over here, Ralph?
Nothing. Field.
So what's this stuff?
That's a truck bodies. With this door, that's where the house is going, right there.
Okay.
And those will be gone.
This is your shed?
Yes.
Which is right.
The cement, all that. Containment area.
The shed he's talking about.
That's a different one. That's
something different.
Yes. That's a containment for...
Okay.
Went to saw.
Okay. And where did you say the house was going?
Right with the container.
Right with
the.
Okay.
Yeah. So that shed. There's a couple buildings in here.
There's a couple buildings that existed.
Yeah.
We added the. You got a container saw. Undercover. So.
Yeah.
And you are up there in the woods, aren't you, Connor?
Yes. There's nobody around. I can see the top of this house here, mm-hmm. And that's it. And that's the other thing, is I have a lot of equipment up there and there's nobody there. And all that's now the neighbors are very watchful. You gotta have somebody there.
Yep.
There's some trails up in there too.
There's an ATV trail that cuts across the corner of my hand.
Yeah.
And goes on the blocks. Which is closed because of the mud season.
Maybe May 18th, I think, right?
I'm not sure what it is. They rattled it up and we called and they come right over and closed it. Yeah, we're pretty good.
So, we good?
Yeah. Are we all set?
Thank you for your time. So, I guess somebody needs to make a motion to continue unless it.
We already made a motion.
Oh, you didn't? Okay.
It was voted on approved.
Okay.
I'll bring the application in to you tomorrow.
That's fine.
Oh, can I just email it back to you? Sure.
Yeah, you could do that.
If you could copy me,
yep.
That would be helpful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good night.
That was the only agenda for correspondence.
So Richard, so what you're only doing in something like this is someone's coming before us with a plan, and they might, we'll be checking it for setbacks and drainage, lighting,
wetland encroachment,
all these types of things. And so this was, and John is our technical advisor. He's got a great deal of expertise, and we rely on his great knowledge. And so this was kind of an odd start for you folks in the sense that whether or not, you know, this matter even belonged here. So, but anyways. All right, so next on the agenda is... Nothing.
Approval of minutes, which got done, and I forgot to send them out, so we'll have to table those until next.
Yeah. Right. I will table those until next time.
Correspondence.
We have none.
None. And then just other business, if there's any.
Well, since we're, I don't think we're prepared to do it tonight, but since we have two new members, I don't know what the agenda is like going to be like in May, but I do think that we ought to take a half an hour or so to sort of run through, just so you guys sort of understand what your, you know, what your roles are.
I kind of like that idea.
Yeah, I mean, I'm assuming you've never done this before.
No.
Yeah, and I haven't seen you milling around the meetings at night, so it doesn't need to be just me, but you know, I can put together something and maybe the board can explain, and maybe we can even pull out some other site plans and some subdivisions and just sort of show you what we do, what a typical meeting would entail.
Yeah.
I don't know where you, if you're both, you know, if you've been in Rollinsford a long time, but you know, unlike the surrounding towns, for some reason Rollinsford hasn't grown like everybody else, so we don't get our agendas are relatively light. I would suspect we'd miss a couple meetings a year because we have nothing. Right?
About two, I think, on average.
Two on average. So, you know, whereas in Dover, they meet twice a month, and they have long agendas, and, you know, Lee, Madbury, they're all busy, but for some reason, Rollinsford is a sleepy town. There's not a whole lot of subdivision activity happening. I don't even know how many applications we get a year. Five or six, maybe seven?
We had 12.
12?
Last year. But some of them
are small, a little lot line adjustment. Anytime a lot line is moved in New Hampshire, you need planning board approval. Unlike Maine, where surveyors have the right to move lines. So if someone wants to make a minor adjustment to a lot line between their lot and their neighbor's lot, they need our approval. So that could be an application, but it might take 5 minutes. And then we might have something as complicated as the blue and mill that took 4 months, 5 months. I don't even know how long it took. It was at the zoning board, and it was at the planning board. Then I went to the zoning board and came back to the planning board. So, you know, there's those.
Is that how it typically goes to the zoning
board? No. The way it's supposed to go is that the planning board cannot approve and shouldn't accept an application unless the application satisfies all the requirements of the zoning ordinance. So in this case here tonight, I think there was, I don't know what happened, but there was Tom Clark, who's the building inspector and does some code enforcement for the town, I think felt that this was the purview, it was the planning board's purview to deal with. We obviously disagreed, and that's rare that happens. Tom has done this a long time. He's an expert. So we typically, when he sends something to the planning board, usually it's the right board. The Blue and Mill was another sort of a messed up situation where we got knee deep into the, or maybe neck deep into the review, and we realized there was a zoning ordinance that we thought we had changed that we didn't change. So they had to go back to, it was a density. It was density, Sarah, wasn't it? They wanted more density than be allowed.
What's density?
How many units they could have per acre. So they had to go back to the zoning board. I don't even know. It might have been more than one meeting.
It's just one.
One meeting. So that's not the norm. Usually, if an application comes to us and we realize they need zoning relief, we don't accept the application. We just say go away, get what you need, come back.
Yep.
Can I ask what that mill you're talking about?
Yeah.
What mill is it? I mean,
it's the mill right over there.
Across the street and halfway down the hill.
It's referred to as the Blue and Mill.
It was Blue and Manufacturing for many, many
years.
Yeah.
As you're going down the hill in town, it's right here. They're expanding their parking lot. They're digging back into the embankment a little bit. They've actually begun that work. All the asphalt's gone now. By a day or two.
And so that was a manufacturing facility. In fact, it was Rollinsford's largest employer for many, many years. When they stopped manufacturing there a while ago, it sort of turned into a warehouse, I think. And somebody bought it, and they converted the upper three floors.
I think there's four floors, and then the fifth is the bottom, which is...
The bottom is going to be
commercial.
Retail, they don't really know. The owner doesn't know. Commercial of some sort. And the top three floors are going to be residential. So that came to us. I can't think of another. We just got done doing a subdivision that had some controversy to it.
Clement Road.
It was controversial. Because we allow duplexes on any lot created in the town, and a lot of the people of the surrounding were like, "Whoa, what is this?" You know, they weren't aware of it, and so and there were some other issues that we had to resolve.
We had to pay some attention. He came back to us after the fact.
He wants to single family residence.
Change it back. We do get some that are one meeting in and out the door.
Yeah.
You know, unchallenged, uncontested, you know, with no negative input from residents.
Right.
You know, we get those as well.
And then we had the Chinburg subdivision right over here in town. Mm-hmm. And that was a lengthy review. I don't know, four or five months maybe? You'd know. It was a few months. So that's sort of the range, you know, anywhere from 4 or 5 months to, and that's, I'd say that's very unusual.
Yeah.
The typical review is, I would say 2 months, you know, in large part because someone comes in and we realize that there's some things they need to do, so they have to come back to sort of tidy up the application and then we'll approve it. But,
and what's fortunate too is any development town usually uses the same handful of civil engineers that know what we're looking for and prepares plans accordingly. They know how we like to see it. You know, I mean,
right.
We have Chinburg, who's someone who's very familiar with, running similar projects. But we've had some changes along the way with how we've zoned the mills downtown, and you know, also trying to keep an open mind on broadening our tax base and changing some of our zoning as far as uses to maybe help something future-wise.
And we had an odd one recently, right down Oak Street. That sliver of land that runs along the railroad track.
Oh yeah.
That was slated for self-storage, wasn't it? Yeah.
What went from the ZBM for self-storage was denied, and now it's going to be duplex.
And now it's going to be
or two duplex
lots.
Yeah.
And that duplexes. Took. Actually, we did that in one meeting because I basically said the planning, which is something I don't normally do. I said to the plan, they were represented by a really good attorney that lives in Dover, has done a fair amount of work in Rollinsford. And an engineer that does a lot of work in Rollinsford. And in advance of the meeting, I said it wasn't going to fly. They retooled the project, came back to before they even got to the planning board, and the planning board, I think, liked it, and it got approved in one night. So, you know,
but approved for its first stage, which is, you know, is that site appropriate for this proposed use? And that was like the end of the conversation for that first step. And then they have to go to ZBA because it's a non-conforming lot.
Right.
And then it'll be back to the planning board to talk about the particulars.
Well, actually, it won't. If they get a variance, it doesn't need to come back because the subdivision it's done. They don't need a site plan review or anything. If the zoning board approves it, they're on their way. They wouldn't have to come back to us because it's already two lots of record.
Two lots of record, but I don't think this body approved the merger of the lots. Like it was about that was noticed as a conditional approval.
I think everybody on the board, I thought it was a good result. Everybody was happy with the way it worked out, and I don't know if it's, I would assume that's the one that's going to the zoning board. So,
some of the things we had is C&J came in front of us, and they wanted to add a building for washing, I believe, buses in storage.
Yeah.
And then on the way, I can never think of the name of, across the bridge, the gentleman that owns Wormwood Gardens wanted in the recycling wants to put in a, came in for approval for a self-storage.
Yeah, it's approved.
We approved that, and you know, things like lighting and
bathroom facilities,
parking, right?
Yeah.
What was it?
Yeah.
It was on Greenview Drive.
Right, thank you, Greenview.
You know where do you know where Greenview Drive is?
No.
You know, you drive over the old castle by Summersworth.
I do.
It's the road right here.
Is that approval expiring soon?
That was a while ago.
January
last year.
I don't know. We should look
at
it. Because he was like, if we got
it, it was
a
good
thing. They have an expiration. I've never seen them expire one before.
It's not a neighborhood. It's a commercial. It's a commercial subdivision. I think actually Kevin may work out there, but it is a pretty cool facility. It's an oil recycling facility.
I know what that is. Yeah.
Yeah, that's at the very end of the road.
Yeah, I know exactly.
So the self-storage was obviously before
in the field.
Okay. In the field, right? But it got approved, and I guess it never got built. I guess that's something we need to look at. Because I thought they were hot to trot on that thing. I don't know what happened.
Price of steel.
Yeah. And what else we've done?
There was the Susie subdivision. He had a business, which is no longer a business, right. And his home on the lot on Portland Ave.
Right.
And that's non-conforming because both of the businesses are within the 100-foot setback from Portland Ave. But he wanted to split that lot in half. And that was given, I believe, conditional approval, but he never came back and showed that finalized it, met his conditions. So we haven't signed off on that, but we heard that last year.
So last year you heard the lot line endorsement at Cambo.
Oh yeah.
Lot line merger was Jennison, 4-month preliminary consultation.
And then there's the Tarion subdivision on Silver Street. Mm-hmm. Put a house in back of an existing house.
Yep.
Right in front of the cemetery.
Yep.
Yep, Tarion Pepin's site plan review.
Oh yeah, Did he ever get online? Dan Pepin?
I think he's all set.
He's all set.
But as far as a question we've had before is on follow up and policing. I mean, there was supposed to be some asphalt placed around that back building there. That was part of our approval and
yeah, at least the handicap. There was lights.
Yeah, and on really to keep vehicles off the gravel. And you know, policing is one thing that we really don't have anyone to. It's all a volunteer board and everyone.
So if you bring those things to my attention, then we can send a letter and get Tom Clark on it and work on it. It's more about people noticing. For now, that's our compliance strategy, which is highly insufficient. We don't have enough staff to actually patrol things that have been approved and patrol businesses, for example, and make sure that everybody's.
So let's talk about Dan Pepin. He gets approved in November. The paving, I think it was November last fall. Paving plants are closed, so I'm assuming Tom gives him a building permit. He needed renovations to the building, right? I think he did.
He was modifying it.
I'm sure he needed a building permit. So what's the trigger to go back out this spring and say, okay, now that you're occupying the building, when is the parking lot going to be paved? When is the lighting going to get installed?
Well, and what is that checklist for all the things, except for the plan itself and the minutes? But, you know, we don't really have a mechanism for checking that, and also the plans and the planning files remain a mess, so it's not
in Dover, for instance. We'll just pick on Dover because they're close to us. Dan Pepin would put up $50,000 in cash or a bond or something, surety, to make sure that it got done. He'd be pretty excited to get his money back, so he'd make sure that work got done. Because usually it's 150%
that makes sense.
With something like a small business like Pepin's, you're probably not going to make him do that because it was probably $10,000. I don't know.
But something to incentivize somebody to follow.
Or just to make sure the town, because it's,
I happen to sit on the zoning board in my time. I've sat on the zoning board for 9 years in the town I live in. And there's nothing more aggravating than determining, making decisions and that are predicated on certain things happening. And then a year later, you realize those things never happened.
Yes.
Because they slipped through the cracks.
Yes.
And this board spends a lot of time looking at a light or paving or some or drainage, and then all of a sudden we realize it never happened because there was no follow. It can be aggravating. So I don't, maybe it's time for a joint meeting with, you know, the Board of Selectmen and Tom to say, how can we, short of, you know, making people put up money to guarantee these things are done, is there another mechanism? Because there's a lot of small business owners in town that may not have the ability to put up $20,000 or $30,000.
But even on that same property, we were unsure when it was previously approved, whether it's a Quonset hut, and we were like, was that supposed to be taken down? Is that supposed to be?
Right.
We weren't even sure. You know.
So we need like something in their property file that says what was approved and
isn't there a checklist?
With a timeline.
Well, this board's jurisdiction ends the day we stamp the plan. That's it. We're done.
Right. But this board can still create a list of, you know, yes, but it can also provide lists or some kind of description or something that could, you know, before it's all finalized.
That's why I think it'd be nice to have Tom in here, because most of the projects require a building permit. So if Tom was given a copy of the approved plan with the conditions of approval, for instance, then he'd say, okay, before I give them a certificate of occupancy, I'm going to make sure XYZ is done and all the things shown on the site plan are done. Now, it's February and they need to pave their parking lot. I'll give them a conditional occupancy permit. And by August 15th, I want all the stuff done when we can pave and we can landscape, something like that.
So right now, I know of what happened in recent history, so that when we get a building permit, that's a flag for me, and we're pretty good that way. That doesn't cover things like, did Pepin pave his parking lot? Where, you know, is he choosing not to follow up with the conditions, and he's just not going to build, you know, submit a building permit because he's just not ready to, or he's
well. That's why I said
down,
if we give
you know,
Tom. I think it'd be helpful to have Tom here because he's worked in. I know he's worked in Dover. I don't know where else he worked, but he's done this for, you know, he's done this a long time. He may say, give me a copy of the site plan that's approved or the whatever it is, the approved plan, the conditions, and he'll make sure those things are done before final occupancy or something.
I
you know, in the case like Dan Pepin, I think he's also an inspection station.
He was applying for that. I don't know if he got that, but
I
don't
every
recall
year that every year that's renewed, either Tom.
I
or
think
Slumber
it may be a. I don't know that it's every year. It may be like a 5-year thing or something.
Well,
so I get what you're saying, and I completely agree with you. And I think we can work on that. It would also be helpful if this body can impart upon people, and I don't know if it's legal, but can we give people a reasonable deadline by which they will meet their conditions, or they revert, or something. And paving, we would want to be, you know, sympathetic to the fact that you can't
sure.
do it in the winter.
Seasonal,
you know, you
yeah.
have to be, you know, compassionate about it, but also have something for Tom to enforce.
But until recently, we didn't even have a town administrator. Now we have the benefit of that position. Obviously, yourself. I mean, I think we are developing these ideas that we have.
But in all our years, we've never had a meeting with Tom. So it may be.
I'm with you. We can do it.
Yeah. If he's willing to. You know,
I'm sure he is.
I think because we want to help him, and I'm sure he wants to try to help us, which reminds me, Paul's Integrity Auto has cars double parked over there that are not allowed. So that might be behoove someone to follow up on that.
Well, we ought to be sensitive to the fact that if we're going to jump on him about that.
That was another lengthy review we went through.
But
yes,
keep in mind,
we
were all about him not selling cars. Not at his previous original shop, there's been cars for sale.
And we sent him a letter, and Tom's been on that. And,
is it Paul doing that, or is it somebody else?
It's Joe's garage, where Paul's Integrity used to be, on the corner of Prospect.
Oh,
and also, Pepin, who said, of course I'm not going to be selling cars, had a truck out for sale as well.
Yes.
He
well,
said
that
he was
truck
not.
It's still there, just the for sale sign.
The for sale sign,
but
it's on Craigslist,
but
still there.
So
yeah, exactly.
But that's what I'm saying. You know, we're going to totally enforce things on Paul. That, and granted, we did make Joe go through the same situation. And quite honestly, Paul probably didn't need to go to the degree that he did when he was at his old shop. because that's exactly what Joe's doing, and Joe just simply put open sign on the door and ran with it.
But yet the site review carries, because it's the same use, different owner, same use, so whether or not...
Well, there's no site review on that, on the old Paul's, on Paul's old site.
This is why you want to transition.
I don't think so. Well, I never saw it, I've been here for years, too many years. We never looked at that old site.
I agree.
Really?
No.
I think we'd have found stuff if we looked at that old site, to be honest with you.
That's been a garage since the beginning of time, probably pre-zoning, I would assume.
It is, I bet it is.
But
there was a question of abandoned use at some point.
Yes, and it went through a process, and it was discussed about selling.
It may have been a zoning process, not the planning.
But I don't believe it was a full site review. I don't believe we did full site.
Okay.
So, just tell me what that means. Somebody use it for a particular...
So the way our ordinance works, and it may not be particularly legal, our ordinance says that a non-conforming use I think we have a year. In the event that a non-conforming use is discontinued for 365 consecutive days, it shall not be reestablished except by a variance granted by the zoning board of adjustment. There's been Supreme Court cases in New Hampshire that would invalidate that for very specific uses. I'm familiar with one because I was a town planner in Conway, New Hampshire years ago. Somebody had an ice cream freezer facility in a residential zone where Ben and Jerry's was stored. And it was a unique building just to that use. It took them 5 years to rent it out. And someone said, we had the same thing, we had a year. And the court said, no, it might take them 20 years to find a suitable tenant. So that the 365 days is kind of not, you can't really hold anybody to that. But the more important language that the courts have said is that if there's an intentional act to abandon a use, let's say Paul's, I think, what's it called up there?
Joe's.
Yeah. Let's say Joe's, since he's going to camera this thing out, we're gonna convert it. This happened in the old bar, what's the bar right down here?
On Church Street?
The Sportsman's Club. So a woman wanted to reopen the Sportsman's Club. I don't know a whole lot about it, but we heard that she had converted it into apartments. Is that right? If there's an intentional act to abandon or to change something, you know, if he wanted to convert that into apartments or the owner of the Sportsman's Club cut it up into apartments, they can't go back and say, well, we're still grandfathered. You can't have it both ways. So that's sort of what we're talking about. But the fact that there's an approved site plan, I don't believe there's an approved site plan for Joe's Garage because it's so old.
You mean it's never been approved?
It's never been approved.
Ever.
Mixed construction.
Conforming use means something that predated zoning, was in existence before the zoning laws came around.
Which is 1971.
Before any of us were around.
Yes.
1971.
But we see more than our fair share of that, believably, here.
Yeah.
You know, there's residences in places that shouldn't be residences.
And we can't, and I wouldn't say definitely 1971 is the date. It's the date it should be. Like, I'm assuming mix has been around since before 71.
So it would predate zoning. So 1971 is the marker. That's when zoning, the zoning ordinance was originally established.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So before that, it didn't matter.
It didn't matter.
And now it's
there may have been something that was built in 78 that sort of simple cracks. I don't know how we'd ever prove it after 40 years, but the law says if it was built before we had zoning, or before the zoning changed to not allow it, it would be non-conforming.
Other question with this, if you don't mind my asking, nobody's complained about that building now. It's been there for how
which,
long?
Which building?
Joe's. So now it's there, and now you bring it up. Hey, this is not conforming.
Bring it up.
No, I'm just saying. Whoever brought it up. So is it this boy's job to go look at that and say?
Well, it's ongoing. It's in play. Well, we run into things like that too with, uses of junkyards and tow yards, and we run into situations of on Clement Road, whether or not there's legal occupancy in buildings that were formerly used for other structures. So
the way that the way that Paul's
ended up as we go,
the way that Paul's ended up in our lap, actually the way I think Paul sort of got, I don't want to say chased out of Joel's garage, but the way he left it is that that was a service station, and I think at one point he was selling a ton of cars there. He had four or five or six cars that were unregistered, inoperable. It was sort of turning into a junkyard. He had ATVs there. So it had gone way beyond just a service station that we would have seen in the 1960s.
Gotcha.
And so that's what caught the attention of the board. So I think he decided that it was more this location was more suitable to him. It was bigger. And he laid out all his cards. He said, this is where I'm going to park. If I have cars for sale, this is where they're going to be, blah, blah, blah. There's customer parking, there's handicap parking. So we ironed out all those details. I just happened to notice today that he does have more cars in the lot than he's supposed to. And I'm sure the selectmen are going to deal with that immediately. But, so that's, that's how that got our attention. This thing, I will tell you that it's troubling to me that, there's buildings that were built on their own permits, obviously, that I don't know if they should ever have been issued.
Yes, and how do you address those things now when they operated with best intentions, with what they were to understand was their process?
I don't know, I don't want to say I don't care, but that's not my problem. I mean, that's somebody else's problem. It's the same way, Mick Construction got a permit from the Board of Selectmen to put a second floor in their building. The planning board literally went ballistic and said, how did they get that? And the board came in and sort of said, oops, we made a mistake. And they did. They were a new board. They made a mistake. We all make mistakes. I don't know how this happened out there, but it did, and now we're going to have to pick up the pieces and figure out how to go forward.
Well, we had a similar situation. C&J's adding another bay to an existing building that went to the select board, and construction was already ongoing
when
it was discovered. But we're all working together.
Not only did they get a building permit, but in the intervening time, the planning board had increased the wetland setback. So then they had a problem. Remember, they had to get a variance. The selectmen gave them a permit to expand the building, which they should never have given. And again, they realized they made a mistake. I wish Mike was here because he would acknowledge his mistake. And then I think we increased the setback from 25 to 50 feet, so they couldn't even make it work. They had to get a variance. So and again, we worked it out because it had to be worked out. But in a perfect world, we'd have a blank slate. Someone would come in for a use that was permitted. We'd get a site plan or subdivision approval, and it would go through the planning board. We would never send it to the zoning board, but it's not the way it works.
It's a small town America, and that's, I'm sure we're not the only community that you're trying to do the right thing.
And it doesn't sound like a major obstacle.
I mean, we're not here. It's not us against the town. We're not here to look for a reason to deny things. We're here to work with residents and find what fits and what works and what satisfies everybody.
It was subdivisions, and we have a pretty good system. The planning board has required, like when the Chinburg subdivision was built, and I think when Greenview was built, we had stipulated as part of the approval that they put up, they post enough security to make sure that our town engineer, we use civil consultants in South Berwick, and they inspected those roads throughout the process. So that works out well for us. Commercial is is kind of different. We rely on Tom to do that. Mm-hmm. I think it's generally works fine.
I have to ask about urban residential zoning. That's where I happen to live, in that kind of zone. And I don't want to say the street or even the number of the street but it's like this urban residential, and we're continually nervous about someone with the business out of their house with a lot of chemicals.
I know exactly where you mean, and that's been through code enforcement more than once, and it's been through the select board more than once, and I understand your concern, and you can see it from a neighboring street very clearly, and it's not,
we have every so often we get a case of the nerves, but other times we just try to drive by.
Yeah, he's denied that it's a business use, and it's
blatant.
Yes, but I saw it myself recently because I hand-delivered the voter's guides to all the places that are not serviced by Rollinsford Post Office. And
yeah.
saw that again. So I don't know that there's anything we can do about it, honestly, when you're denying a business use, but yet you have refuse in your yard that's unscreened, that is clearly not residential in nature.
Yeah.
But I hear your frustration and share it.
So maybe that's, we worry about our urban residential, we're like, it's such a nice quiet street.
Yeah, so you know, the short answer is, you know, the zoning ordinance starting on page 38 or so gives you the table of uses. And those are the things that are allowed, and it tells you the districts in which they're allowed, and if it's not listed, it's not allowed.
Wait, who enforces that, Caroline?
Well, if we are aware of such a thing, then we would send a letter and require, well, so it depends on how it comes about. A lot of time, I get a lot of foot traffic in my office and phone calls about, I either own a property or I'm interested in a property and I want to do X, whatever use. And I direct them to the zoning ordinance, and if it's allowed, you go through planning, and if it's not allowed, good luck, but you can try the ZBA. If there's a use going on that is brought to the town's attention by way of a complaint, then we send Tom Clark out to verify whatever's going on and talk to the owner and see what it might be and see if it falls within here and whether or not they should go to planning or zoning or whether or not they're going to...
So typically it's Tom Clark who actually goes on site.
Yes, but it's not something that we would necessarily become aware of if it weren't for people who live in neighborhoods who have to deal with neighbors. Yes.
Right. No, I certainly understand that. But you'd have to come through here first, or at least Tom Clark first.
Tom Clark is usually the first step on behalf of the town to assess what is the situation, or like visually at least, what is the situation, and then from there, what do we do about it? In which case, either planning or zoning, or they correct it and it goes away.
Okay. Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you for asking.
Well, we also do things on the board in the past is, a lot of times it's a matter of definition, how you interpret certain the way things are written in our subdivision regulations or zoning regulations. You know, each year, I'm not going to say each year, but often when you go to vote, you'll see just that we want to change some wording of things to make it a little tighter, a little less vague, so that you can have an interpretation and I can have an interpretation.
Right.
You know, what is a pet, sort of, you know, just things like that. For example.
That came about.
For example.
Yes.
For example, what is a pet, what is livestock?
Yeah, right.
You know, but we do our best on that, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And any word in there is subject to interpretation, and it's for the applicant to argue and for us to interpret and, you know, see where the dust
goes. So we try, like most recently this year, we had some wording changed and just to make things a little, and to make flow a little bit better as far as the select board signing off on things and their assigns.
Which is going to help a lot. It's already helped a lot. So I now Tom Clark, we've joined the rest of Southern New Hampshire in allowing our business, our building inspector to sign off on building permits and COs. So those are no longer going to the select board. So that's a major service improvement to residents and the professionals who work on their behalf and trying to get permits, because the delay was sometimes considerable.
And that's buried on the select board.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. So yeah, we try to do things like that.
And then finally, we haven't done a lot of them lately, but if there are applications or projects that come in for either subdivision or site plan approval, oftentimes we'll schedule a site walk. Again, for the ones that you need to see, like the subdivision on Clement Road. I think I don't know if we all went out there. We went out individually, but We will do those. One of the things that I'm going to try to set up I'd sort of like to get the board and maybe the board of selectmen through the Blue and Mill, because everybody was sort of interested to see how it was going, how it turned out. So I'm hoping to get in touch with the owner and see if we can schedule a field trip over there maybe before one of our planning board meetings, just to see because a lot of times we approve something and we never know how it really turns out because we never get to see it. So.
So another thing that falls under the purview of this group is the master plan. And the master plan, I think John can probably speak best to that. Its last final version was 2010, but you've done a couple chapters since
then.
We did the whole thing over.
We did chapter by chapter, probably two or three chapters a year. So the statute in New Hampshire says that the master plan is supposed to be updated periodically, and periodically is defined as generally every 5 years. No one ever sues a town saying your master plan is 20 years old, and in a town like Rollinsford where very little changes, there's probably not a need to update it, you know, every year. It's expensive, it's time consuming. But we probably ought to start looking at that, and there's a few things that we should look at. One, if you know Mike Rollo, Mike was at one point trying to establish an economic development committee that never got off the ground in an effort to try to find a way to expand the town's tax base to try to either stabilize or lower the tax rate. And we've talked, you all both need to know that Route 4 is never going to change until hell freezes over, so that's never going to have commercial buildings on it. But we've also looked for opportunities to try to find ways to maybe look at other areas of town. One of them has always been Oak Street, whether or not there's an opportunity there. This planning board also took a huge step 8 years ago
regarding the mills.
For many, 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 many years, no one, that the town administration, I would say the Board of Selectmen, not necessarily the Planning Board, but the Board of Selectmen was adamantly opposed to allowing residential development in the mill buildings. In light of what's happened in Portsmouth, Somersworth, Dover,
New Market.
My former employer was Chinburg Builders, so I have a lot of experience with mill redevelopment. The Planning Board finally came, or that the planning board finally sort of brought it to a head and said, we really think that it's time to allow residential development in the mill buildings. So now we allow it. Sadly, the Cutter family, who owns the bulk of the mill buildings in downtown, went through, I would say, hell trying to get their buildings up to code, and I don't think they have an appetite to make any changes now. So the Blue and Mill was one that has been changed. There's probably there are other mills that aren't owned by the Cutters. I mean,
they own the two, the upper mill,
yeah,
and the lower mill. They even own a lot
as
of
well
the,
as
a lot of the stuff on Front Street.
Right. So, maybe over time we'll see. I mean, the play, it was a huge, it was something that took probably 4 or 5 years of discussions, looking at the economics of it. Unfortunately, right now we have the Blue Mill, that's it. But maybe over time, the upper floors of the big mills could be converted into residential units. And the board's thought at the time was, it would not only create a new use for the upper floors of the mills that are really underutilized, but largely the people that buy or lease or rent those units don't have children, so it wouldn't have an impact on our schools, and they might actually, they might actually support downtown businesses, which really seem to struggle. So that was sort of our collective thinking. It just, so far we don't have any results.
But even with that upside potential, it might be of more interest to a developer to perhaps, pursue a sale with the current owners because it has that upside option.
Yep.
But the Cutters may never take action on it, and that's absolutely their right. But there might be also Mr. Moneybags that comes along and knows that he can convert those into residential, and it might be a cash cow for him, where he could, make an offer.
I will say that Chinburg is converting a second mill in Somersworth right now, which is,
the It's the further one,
the
yeah.
The one closest to GE, yeah. They're converting that out. Yeah. So in the first building, which is gigantic, I think the average rent over there is either $1,600 or $1,800 a month. They're beautiful units. And to get in there, it's not nice. I mean, you got to go through a nasty alley, buy hot bread, pizza. It's not a
very
not,
tight street.
It's yeah. a tight street.
But he's also got commercial use in there as well.
But my point is, if that can work there, it can work here. Mm-hmm. These are beautiful buildings, you know, nice streets. It can work. If it can work in Somersworth, you know, 5 miles away, it can certainly work here. But it's going to be time before it happens, mm-hmm. you know.
I just don't see any parking down there for that many people moving in.
Well, there's more parking here than there is at the Somersworth. Yeah, they have a fair amount of parking here. It may not be right next to the building, but they've gotten through the site plan approval process. They have quite a bit of parking.
Really?
Yeah, and with Blueland, they didn't have enough parking. So it was a trade-off. We figured that some of the tenants would be gone during the day when the commercial use was in operation. So there's also some swapping or sharing of parking.
Sharing, yeah.
That could certainly happen in the mill building. But again, until something happens down there, we won't know. But.
And that's a perfect example of us working with the developer to try to make it happen. You know, we just didn't dig our heels in and say, doesn't fit, you know, how can we get there from here?
And we've looked at other locations, like I said, we've looked at Oak Street, but there just isn't a whole lot of opportunity there, and now there's some houses going in, so probably, but, you know, I think that this board is always open to, you know, to trying to find ways to, you know, expand the tax base.
Well, tell me about this master plan. Where is that located?
I don't know. That's a good question. It was located on the former chairman's computer. It's probably, I'll try to hunt down copies.
There's one paper copy in the board's office.
So maybe we could make copies of that.
That would be excellent.
Assuming that it's the most up-to-date.
Kevin was involved.
Yeah, we added chapters, we rewrote existing chapters. It's kind of like a mission statement or a growth plan.
Yeah, whatever it is.
In the town. And you're required to have one.
Yeah.
You know, and if we're going to support certain zoning and subdivision regulations, we have to have a plan that shows the site.
Oh, I agree.
It shows the vision.
Yeah, you always hear in controversial projects, if you read the newspapers, you know, you'll see an angry abutter that'll hold up the master plan and say, it says, you know, we're a rural character, and this isn't a rural character. And he always tells people, well, the master plan is sort of a guiding document. It you know, basically he would say that, you know, we don't want, we don't, the master plan doesn't support the expansion of the dense downtown area in Rawlinsburg. And if we tried to rezone this area or, you know, an area to expand the downtown, it would be inconsistent with the master plan. So that's sort of what it's for. Mm-hmm. Not to say, you know, this house is ugly. It doesn't exist.
It's not rules and regulations. It's just a broad picture.
Yeah, it's a broad picture.
Yeah.
But it was also, there's a lot of good information about there. Like, it was shocking to us that that the population in Rawlinsburg shrunk between 2000 and 2010. It was the only town south of the White Mountains that shrunk.
Well, people died.
I think in 10 years we built, I can't remember, 25 houses. It was
not a lot.
Not a lot of houses. A couple a year, but the town shrunk. And yet, you know, all the surrounding towns like Dover, Madbury, Lee, Berwick, Southbrook, they all grew astronomically. And not astronomically, but a lot.
Enough.
A lot. Yeah.
There's a difference.
And we thought, I think there were some of us that thought, and no one can really tell us why. We thought that it was probably largely a result of the fact that a lot of people wouldn't send their kids to Somersworth schools. Now that the kids aren't going to Somersworth, nothing's really changed. So I don't know if that was it or not, but there's not a real explanation as to why our growth it wasn't growth, it was shrinkage. Mm.
So yeah, now we get things like the development behind the church, you know, 15 new single-family houses. We've got happening there on Clemmer Road,
yeah.
There, Gagnon there.
We do have some stuff.
We've got some things like that happening, you know. I mean, if the mills ever go residential, that would certainly be it.
And there's a lot of land in Rawlinsburg that's held by
by families.
Right.
It's not in conservation, but they're conservation minded.
Right.
You know, as generations change and maybe right. people die and kids get a hold of maybe, you know, you never know. Some of that land can sprout houses. I don't know. But there is a lot of land that's controlled, that's in conservation and owned by conservation minded people. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean there's not developable land. There is.
Right.
But for some reason, we.
It's mostly, at this point, huge swaths of land, like really big parcels. So when it comes up, it's going to be a lot all at once. But there are not a lot of really small parcels.
That aren't developed.
That aren't already developed.
Right. But it's large parcels held by old families with living descendants still along that mindset. And also, I think the general population of the town is we kind of want to keep it as a tight-knit little community, too. I mean, that really is the public consensus. If you know, no one wants to develop Route 4, you know.
Rawls
they
was
like
a lot bigger
the
years
feel,
ago.
You know,
There was a lot more people living in Rawlinsford years ago than there is today.
How long have you been in town?
Long enough.
Yeah, there you go. I don't know.
But it was like 30,000 or something. And when the mills were really
right.
at full employment, it was something
well,
like 30,000.
There were 10,000 people that worked there.
Yeah.
Lived and worked there.
In the days of blooming?
No, I mean the lower mill were like
before
making
that.
Textiles.
Oh, okay.
Before that time.
Okay.
But that was an ebb and flow. You know, people went from here to Summersworth, and you know, it was almost like two communities being one.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask about when you mentioned about expanding tax base, and then when we haven't been here for that's less than 2 years, but so we were looking at Scout's Landing, and it was pointed out how good it was because it was lower taxes, but you have to go get your own mail at the post office. And I thought, well, if mail gets delivered, then the taxes would go up. But
not really, because the post office is a federal service and doesn't affect your tax base at all, because we don't regulate the mail. And we don't decide that you don't get mail on in whatever neighborhood. That's completely the decision of the post office.
Huh.
And I will say, most of the board, everybody else on the board knows, that I wear two hats. I also build houses. I do some residential development. And post offices, I don't know when it was, 10, 12 years ago, they just, across the board, they stopped rural delivery. So every new subdivision I build, you see pods of mailboxes. So it wasn't unique. I'm sure they would have loved to have had household delivery.
Mm-hmm.
It's not up to us. It's a postal service thing. They just stopped door-to-door delivery on new subdivisions. So.
Okay.
There are some people that, you know, sort of sociologists that think those pods of mailboxes at the end of the neighborhoods are sort of a cool thing. And I will tell you, I just finished a huge subdivision, 75 lots in Elliott, Maine, and that's what we have. And it actually is sort of cool. Everybody, the bus won't come into the subdivision, so the people have to go out to the end of the subdivision to get their mail and to pick up their kids. And it's turned into, it's like a little country club out there that everybody talks, they know each other. It actually
social
is stuff. Sort of cool.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's, you know, Scout's Landing, I'm assuming there's not a mailbox pod. I think they come right to the post office. But,
hopefully.
You know, it's that's not something we can control. You know, I think we had the argument with, not the argument, the discussion about school busing going up Scout's Landing, didn't we? Yeah, and I think the
sidewalks.
State of New Hampshire does require at least kindergartners, I think, to be picked up at their door. So
it doesn't happen in this town.
It's a state law, and I know that because I researched it for other towns in my own family. But there may not be any kindergartens over there. I don't know. But that's something we don't control.
Okay. It was so. Just I just remember like the realtor trying to the selling point of but it's lower taxes than over here. What is
yeah.
it?
I mean, we're trying, you know, but with this board can only do so much. But yeah, I think we try.
All right, motion to adjourn.
I'll make the motion.
Second. All right, great. All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. All right, thank you, everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you.